Good morning.
I heard an old, old story,
oh,
how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his glory,
heard about
of his precious blood atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus,
victory,
my Savior forever. He sought me and brought me with his redeeming blood.
With his redeeming blood.
He loved me ere I knew him. All my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea. About the angels singing and the old redemption story, and some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus,
victory,
my Savior forever. He sought me and brought me with his redeeming blood.
With his redeeming,
he loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
Overwhelmed by the victory.
Yes.
There we go. I have a smartphone also. It's a smartphone for dumb rednecks. Still don't know all the things it's supposed to do. And everybody laughs at me. I used to sing that song at the beginning of one of my classes in seminary. And anyway, that y'all didn't care, but I told you anyway. Y'all don't realize this, but there's a screen up there that they put the music on and all, and I don't know what just came up there, but it was really kind of interesting. That's quite all right. Mess me up, but that's quite all right. Let's see what we got for announcements here. That's it. All right. Nominating committee will be this Tuesday evening at 6:30 over here. If you're on the committee, oh, by the way, Roger, you're on that committee. If you're on that committee, please make sure you're there, because it's rather important that we get all these positions filled. Charge conference, you see that, is on the 16th. Which means we have to have our paperwork in on the 9th. So the two things that they want to have done at charge, will have to be done at charge conference. One is my salary, and two is the list of officers for the church. Those are the two main things. Everything else we can kind of fudge on and get when we get there. But that's what it is. Lord is my help. You can see that in your bulletins. Get with Linda on that one. And we talked about that. And Cindy has an announcement. Any other announcements? Do you want anything else, Don? No, you're good. Thank you. All right, let's see. Prayer concerns today. Of course, Sherry Lidgard, we need to keep her in our prayers. Patty's not here. She bent, picked up something, threw her back out, so she is writhing in pain at home. So, well, not really, but she still hurts. Other prayer concerns. Yes, ma'am. Now, start over. All right. Yes, ma'am. Hey, Judy. Deal. And you're here. You already had one, Barbara. You can't, it's a limit. One prayer per. Go ahead. Karen? Yeah. Yes, sir. Okay, I saw another hand somewhere. Sydney? Okay, thank you. Yeah, we actually did that. It was called the Inquisition. I got Nan. What else? Okay. Let's go to the Lord in prayer then. Almighty God, we are thankful that we can come together as your church. Because we know there are many places in this world that just doesn't happen. We are thankful that we have that privilege of being able to worship where and when we want to. We pray for our brothers and sisters throughout the world that don't have that freedom. We pray also, Lord, that you open up our spirits and open up our minds that we may discern what it is that you would have us to do. Help us to remember that you are the one that's in charge, and help us to follow you where you lead. We ask that you give us the courage to be your children, to take a stand, to speak for those who have no voice. To invite in the outcast. The ones that are marginalized. We pray also that you give us courage to be followers, that we open ourselves completely and honestly to you. Teach us how to forgive ourselves as you have already forgiven us. Now, we also come together to pray on behalf of the ones we love, for Sherry and for Patty, for Wendy, for Carl. We ask that you put your healing hands upon them. For Kathy, the teachers, and for all of the school folks, we ask that you be with them and you cover them with your grace. We sing praises to you for Landon and for Judy. Help us as your people to always show your love, your compassion, and your mercy to all of your children. Hear us as we pray with our brethren. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The trumpet calls, lift your voice.
It's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion Hill salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the cloud, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion Hill salvation comes.
Let us join our hearts together as we come to celebrate God's faithfulness with our gratitude. Most gracious God, we do come to you. We do come to you as grateful servants for all the things that you have given us. Most importantly, the gift of life and life more abundantly. Look pleasingly at these, our gifts of tithes and offerings. Amen.
nice? That's the question. Are you always nice? Well, I didn't know we had so many trumpet players. Wow. That made me want to break out my old trumpet. You know, no. Boy, that was a fast response. Who started back to school already? Raise your hand if you've started back to school. All right. You start tomorrow? You start tomorrow, okay. All right. What if do you ever get on computers when you're in school? Get on and have a story on the computer, and you do computer lab. Good. And you, all right, well, let's talk one at a time. What happens is, you get on the computer, and some of the stories you have to read. There's no voice with the story. You have to actually read the words. What would happen? You didn't do your homework over the summer? Okay, well, you're going to get there. But what would happen if you got there to that screen and you couldn't see anything? You would have to have somebody read it to you. You know, we have a story from the Bible today, and one of the things that people who, you know, some people cannot see, even with some people get prescription glasses, like I and you. Some of us, you know, get prescription glasses so we can see better. But you know, there's some people in the world who are blind; they cannot see. But should that stop them just because they're blind? No. And there is a very famous composer of hymns. Her name is Fanny Crosby. And what a lot of people don't know, she wrote a lot of hymns that are in our hymnal. But what a lot of people don't know is she was blind. She couldn't see. But she came up with these wonderful words to these hymns. Like, I am thine, O Lord, and to God be the glory, and some other hymns that we have. Well, Jesus, I guess what my point is that Miss Crosby didn't let being blind stop her. And I'm sure when she was young, there was probably some people that were saying, oh, Fanny, you can't do that. You're blind. Or don't try to do that. You can't see. And it's the same thing that happens in people's lives. They let a disability, because something that they can't do, keep them from trying. Well, guess what? Jesus, in a story this morning, I'll get to you in just a minute, talks about a woman whose daughter was dying. And Jesus and his disciples were on one of these border towns, and she was a Canaanite woman. And she was yelling to the top of her lungs, Jesus, Jesus, come help us. Please come help us. My daughter is dying. And Jesus knew she was a Canaanite woman. And the disciples were saying, Lord, they came to him and said, Lord, can't we just go make this woman be quiet? She's creating a lot of noise, and we can't have our devotional here. And so Jesus, after a little while, he didn't respond immediately, but that woman was persistent, just like Miss Crosby was when she made those songs and everything. She was persistent, and she was going to never give up. Can you say that with me? Never give up. That's right. How do you become blind?
You run into a wall by accident, or you fall down on your face on the
floor. Yeah, you have to be careful. But let me finish the story. What happened was Jesus got up, and he found the woman who was so persistent, and he said, why should I offer the good food that I'm serving, spiritual food that I'm serving to the people of Israel, to the dogs? that seems pretty harsh for Jesus to say that. But Jesus was making a point to his disciples. And the woman said, well, Master, even the dogs deserve to have what falls from the table, the good food that falls from the table. And you don't feed your dog from the table, do you? No? Do you feed your dog from the table? You do? And he finishes those peas that you don't like, right? Yeah? Yeah? You do? Oh, you do like peas. All right. You what?
My dog sits at my table and I just drop the food.
Oh, my goodness. He just sits in the chair at the table? Okay. Okay. But okay. Well, thank you for sharing that. Now back to the story, okay? Jesus finally says to the woman who is so persistent, she never gave up. He says, woman, you have such a great faith. I'm going to answer your request. And she went home and her daughter was healed. And she celebrated. And, you know, it's the same thing. It's the same thing with our faith. We think that sometimes we think that some disability or some struggle in our life we will never be able to overcome. But when we let the light of hope of Jesus into every situation in our lives, guess what happens? He comes and he helps us. So never give up, okay? Can you say it with me again? Never give up. Trust in Jesus. Say that. Trust in Jesus always. Amen. Thank you, kids.
Genesis is the first book. There we go. It's on. It works, doesn't it? Can you hear me? No? There we go. That's better. Let's stand for the reading of God's Word, please. Genesis 45, 1 through 15. Then Joseph could no longer control himself before all those who stood by him. And he cried out, "Send everyone away from me." So no one stayed with him when Joseph made himself known to his brothers. And he wept so loudly that the Egyptians heard it, and the household of the Pharaoh heard it. And Jesus said to his brothers, "I am Joseph. Is my father still alive?" But his brothers could not answer him, so dismayed were they at his presence. Then Joseph said to his brothers, "Come closer to me," and they came closer. He said, "I am your brother, Joseph, whom you sold into Egypt. And now do not be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me here. For God sent me before you to preserve life. For the famine has been in the land for 2 years, and there is 5 more years in which there will neither be plowing nor harvest. God sent me before you to preserve for you a remnant on earth, and to keep alive for you many survivors. So it was not you who sent me here, but God. He has made me father to Pharaoh and lord of all his house and ruler over all the land of Egypt. Hurry and go and get my father and say to him, 'Thus says your son, Joseph, God has made me lord of all Egypt. Come down to me, do not delay. You shall settle in the land of Goshen, and you shall be near me, you and your children, your children's children, as well as your flocks, your herd, and all that you have. I will provide for you there, since there will be 5 more years of famine to come, so that you and your household and all that you have will not come to poverty. And now your eyes and the eyes of my brother Benjamin see that it is my own mouth that speaks to you. You must tell my father how greatly I am honored in Egypt and all that you have seen. Hurry and bring my father down here.' Then he fell upon his brother Benjamin's neck and wept, while Benjamin wept upon his neck. And he kissed all his brothers and wept upon them. And after that, his brothers talked with him." The word of God for the people of God. I'll be with you in a minute. Here's an old Garth Brooks song. I never thought I'd say old Garth Brooks song, but called "Unanswered Prayers." I love that one. You know, he talks about going back to a high school football game and saw the girl he really thought he wanted to marry, and thank goodness he didn't. And that's pretty much the gist of the song. You know, we ever had that happen, that we thought we wanted one thing and we really pushed hard to get that one thing and it didn't happen. But what we found out was there was something better and bigger and better on the other side that we weren't expecting. I think that's where Joseph was, actually. I don't think he meant to go get himself thrown in a pit, nor did he mean to get himself thrown into jail, nor did he mean for himself to be the Pharaoh's chief counsel. I wonder how many of us, if we were sold into slavery, we would just wait for that day that we could repay that kindness. You ever think about that? How long will it take? You know, Joseph is an interesting character in a lot of ways. He was his daddy's favorite son, really, I mean, it's obvious, by his favorite wife. And, you know, some of this stuff I think Joseph brought on himself. I mean, you don't go tattletale all the time. You know, that's what he did. He went and told on his brothers. He had a dream. He couldn't wait to tell his brothers, "Hey, guess what this means? You're going to bow down to me." You know, that's just not the right way to do things. But it's an interesting thing. You know, here's a guy who was sold into slavery. Got put in jail on a trumped-up charge. He didn't do anything. Helped out a guy that had a dream, and that guy got released. And what happened to him? He got to stay. But he doesn't have bitterness about him. I hadn't quite figured that one out just yet. Some of the things I don't think we really pay attention to and think about with Joseph. His brothers got to be the rich men of the family. They got to stay there with Daddy, and they got things and all that. And Joseph became a chief counsel. He was over all of Egypt. But think about something. He didn't have a country. He didn't have a family. I mean, they gave him an Egyptian name, but he wasn't an Egyptian. But he wasn't a Hebrew either, because he wasn't really practicing being a Hebrew. He wasn't in a Hebrew family. So he really was without a country and without a family. We think about him always being so powerful, but he had no identity to go with that. So we know the story. The brothers come down, and he recognizes them. So now he is going to reveal himself. He says, I am Joseph. The first question, what is the first question he asked? Is my father still alive? I wonder, if it's all he wants is to see his dad once again, he wants to be a son, he wants an identity again as Joseph ben Jacob, the son of Jacob. That's what he wanted. He wanted to. He didn't want the power. He wasn't obsessed with all. He wanted to be a son. Now, I wonder sometimes as we wander away from the pack, wander away from God, is it that we really want to be a child of God once again? You ever think about that? When we wander off? It says, I am your brother Joseph, whom you sold into Egypt. Can you imagine what was going through those guys' head about that time? I mean, that was an uh-oh moment. Big time. Yeah. Yeah, we don't get the whole flavor of this thing, but I can tell you it wasn't quite as sanitary as we got it recorded. You know, these guys are sitting here thinking, we know what we have done. You know that Joseph wasn't far from their mind ever. They kept the secret hidden for all these years. It was part of who they were. Do you realize what a burden, what a heavy, heavy burden a secret is to carry? I can imagine Gary and Don both can identify with this. I've been told things I really wish I didn't know. I'll just be honest with you. People have told me things that I will have to carry to my grave, and it's a burden, quite honestly, sometimes. That you have to carry somebody else's secret as well. Now here are these 10 brothers. They all were complicit in selling Joseph and lying to their father. They have to go through life always wondering which one's going to squeal, which lie are we going to tell? What has happened, I think, also... Pardon me. A secret is one of those things that defines your life. When you hold that in and everything you do is determined by that secret. But what Joseph also does in this revealing of himself is he reveals to his brothers their own soul to them. We don't like that. We, especially in America, have a real problem with people unmasking us and finding out who the real me is, or letting others know who the real me is. You know, we don't want to be held accountable for that. I wonder who reveals our soul to us. He said, don't be despaired. In other words, we're going to break with the past. We're going to forget the past. We're going to wipe clean that slate. And we're going to start anew as a family. I want you to... I know when you go back and you read your notes from the sermon every Sunday afternoon, because we all keep Sabbath. Let's see, what was it he said again? You go back and reread this passage. Look how many times he says, my father, my family, my brothers. He uses familiar names. He says, we're going to not worry about what happened in the past. We're going to move forward together as a family. You ever think about the risk that Joseph took? I mean, when he revealed himself, he laid himself bare in front of them. He could have been rejected by them. They could have said, oh, well, there's 10 of us and one of you. We'll finish the job this time. The Egyptians could have heard this, and they could have rejected him and says, you're going back home, boy, or back to the prison, one or the other. He took a great risk, but for him, it was worth the risk. He wanted to be a family once again. He says, do not be, for those that don't know, yes, I said bless you, more or less. I said that from the pulpit one time. Somebody sneezed, and I said, Gesundheit. They told the DS I was speaking in tongues. Y'all think I'm kidding. I'm serious. They did. I said it a second time. They said, he's cussing, too. I can cuss in English. I can't cuss in German. I don't know it well enough. You ever notice that's the first thing we want people to teach us when we learn a new language? Is the dirty words. You know? Anyway, he says, I love what he says, though. Look at the next line. He says, don't be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me. I love that line. He's already forgiven his brothers, okay? He forgave them a long time ago. Now what he is saying to his brothers is, you got to forgive yourself. You see, if we believe that God has forgiven us, okay, if God has forgiven us, then when we say we don't forgive ourselves, then we have just put ourselves above God. That we know more, that we're more powerful than God is. Now, the brothers aren't quite sure about this forgiveness thing that Joseph has been saying, because you'll see later on they want a little bit more assurance, but that's a different story. So look further down, and Joseph says, for God sent me before you to preserve life. God sent me before you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to keep you alive for many survivors. If you want to get right down to it, the brothers had lived a life of destroying life. Joseph had always tried to preserve life. I mean, if you look in every one of his instances, his attitude has always been about preserving life. He was always life-centered, not death-centered, if you will. Now, let's think about our own life and where do we see things? Do we see things as life-giving or life-draining? You know, do we make things life-giving or life-draining for other people? You know, what is it that gives us life? You know, is church for you life-giving or life-draining? When our attitude is all about, oh, woe is me and woe is things, that's the brother's attitude. How to destroy things. Or you can have Joseph's attitude that says, no, life's giving. I'm going to carry on the promise, preserving the remnant. It is only through this attitude of life-giving that Joseph can even begin to forgive the brothers for what they've done. But he says, God has always provided us with a remnant. So all the naysayers that say the world is going down the toilet, God's still in charge. God's still in charge of things. And God will always provide a remnant to carry on the promise. I've always said that we are always one generation away from losing the gospel. All it takes is one generation to forget about the gospel, you know. But then I stop and think, God always says that there will be a remnant to remember the promise. Now, last verse in there is, it says that he kissed all of his brothers. He didn't miss one. He went down the line and wept and forgave each and every one of them in restoring the family, if you will. Now, let's look at a few things real quickly. Joseph could have become very cynical, okay? I mean, if you think about it, he had been through so much, waited so long for God to act. He could have become very disillusioned or disappointed. How often is it that we become very disillusioned and disappointed because the great dreams we had have not come to fruition? Well, that's because they're our dreams and they're not God's dreams. We want things to happen like this. I go back to that silly commercial for insurance. You know, 7.5 minutes. Why do you need to get an insurance quote in 7.5 minutes? What is the reason that we need an insurance quote in 7.5 minutes? You ever get on a telephone, call somebody, and you got to go through the series of numbers, right? I hate those things. And what is it we always say? I stayed on that phone for 10 minutes till I got somebody. But then when you look at that little timer, it says you've been on it for about a minute. Okay, we're very impatient society. We would have become disillusioned a long time ago. Joseph could have become very defiant. Because, see, some folks believe that God has a contract with us. That our relationship with God is like our relationship with a landlord or whatever else. We have a contract. We're going to do this. God's going to do this. And if God doesn't do that, God has broken that contract. So, therefore, I will do what I want to do. Okay? He could have become very revengeful at both God and his brothers. He could have spent all those years thinking about how it is when he's in charge. Thinking about he was in charge in spite of God and in spite of his brothers. He could have carried the heaviest load there is to carry, and that's called a grudge. He could have, and we would have said rightfully so, wouldn't we? He could have become discouraged. After all, he was the favorite son of Jacob, wasn't he? The carrier of God's promise. He could have felt that God had left him in the prison, in the pit, in the foreign land. He had forgotten about him. He could have given up and said, no more, I'm done. We always talk about the patience of Job, the faith of Abraham. But well, look at Joseph. I mean, come on. He never gave up. Because in his heart, he always saw the light of God. And he always knew that God is in charge and that God may have different ideas than we do. Now, before I cough to death, here are the takeaways. Joseph teaches us about true forgiveness. See, this stuff we call, oh, I forgive you, but I won't forget, doesn't happen. Forgiveness means we break with the past and we move on toward the future. Right? We also learn that dreams have a way of coming true when they're God's dreams and not our dreams. You see, we always want to look at this very narrow view of what we think is right, of what we think is the right way to go, of what the right thing to do. We don't look at the bigger picture. We don't allow God to open our eyes to the bigger picture. Gary, thank you so much for your prayer request on the religious minorities. Because you know what? We don't suffer with all these other folks. We don't even think about it. It is a privilege that we get to come. It is not a right. It is a privilege that we get to come together in freedom. And guess what? I want to have that same freedom for all those that don't want to come. That want to go somewhere else to worship. Okay? Sometimes the dreams aren't our dreams. They need to be God's dreams. Thirdly, God is still in charge because God works through our lives. All right? Whenever we're in the dark prison of our soul thinking that God has forgotten our name, as Joseph must have felt, God's working. God's plan will not be thwarted no matter how hard we try. Maybe hidden. Maybe mysterious. But God's plans don't depend upon us. They will be fulfilled in time. I love what the bishop says. God does not need the United Methodist Church. But the United Methodist Church sure needs God. And lastly, God has a plan for each of our lives. But until we give complete control of our lives over to God, we live in a prison. Amen. Sorry about that.
Might. I always say I sure am glad they changed my medication so I'd get rid of this cough. That was almost 2 years ago.
If God has laid upon your heart that you just want to spend some time at the altar, in prayer, or if you want to unite with this church, let us be in prayer for a few seconds, a few minutes, as Andy plays something real pretty. Gracious God, we come to you asking that you give us the courage of Joseph to depend upon you, to empty ourselves out and allow you to enter in, to allow you to control each and everything we do. Open our eyes that we may see what your plans are and how we may follow them. It is in your Son's name we pray. Amen. Let us stand and tell everyone what it is that we believe as found in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He ascended into heaven and seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Do you think?
Forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your Spirit is within me because you died and rose again. I'm forgiven. Accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your Spirit is within me because you died and rose again. Die for me.
Good job, Rich.
I even stopped while we were singing.
We're in a road map, Rich.
I even stopped.